evaluation process so that my grade or the percentage marks, whatever I give, it is reliable and valid. Next is assessment. You said assessment. Assessment is a process. Evaluation is not the process. Evaluation will depend on the assessed data. So if I say assessment, why we should take the assessment? Who said that there will be one NSEM and one MIDSEM? What are the criteria for define one MIDSEM and one NSEM? What are the criteria for define internal examination and external examination? What is the criteria why we take the class test? What is the purpose of class test? That means when, what, how much, how. So how much? That means if the MIDSEM, then how much portion I should take as a MIDSEM exam? So any assessment, when, what, how much, how, then what is the interpretation of the result which I get? So all are very important. Next question, what are the different function of assessment? If I ask you why you take class test, what is the purpose for class test? Can you give answer that what is the why you take a class test? Why you take a lab viva? Why you take a comprehensive viva? So what is the different function of assessment is very important. How can you ensure the validity and reliability of those assessments? What are the kind of interpretation can you make? A student's got 70% marks. What is the interpretation? A student got failed. What is the interpretation of the student got? Oh, you fail. Oh, you pass. Not that. How can you make a good assessment plan? And what are the statistical tools for assessment? So there are a lot of statistical tools are there. A lot of statistical tools are used for assessment. So all are the issues in assessment and evaluation. Okay. Now I come to that block diagram. Is it visible? So, if you see that what is our target? Our target is to assess whether a student has achieved the course goal or not. For our assessment purpose, in an engineering college or in a degree college, whatever the college, our purpose is to test whether the learner has attained the course goal or not. So this kind of assessment is called criteria-based assessment. Criteria-based assessment means assess criteria is already predefined. That means the criteria why I take the assessment is already predefined. I want to test whether a learner has achieved the intended course outcomes or not. So that's why it is called criteria-based assessment. Now, when I take the criteria assessment, for what purpose? For evaluating the students. That means I want to quantify the student's performance. That's why I'm designing this assessment. So this assessment, its purpose is only for quantify the student's competence. Now suppose I have designed a question paper, my course outcome, I have a 6 course outcome. If a student achieved 4 course outcome, I have designed the assessment in such a way that all course outcome is tested and I found that 4 out of 6 course outcome, 4 course outcome is attained by a particular student. Then I can say if all outcome are equal importance, and if all outcomes are equal evaluation weightage, then I can say the student's competence is 4/6 × 100. It's clear. So it is 4/6 × 100. If a student achieve only 3 outcome, it is 3/6 × 100. Now the question is, suppose student is not achieved. What as a teacher we do? the questions, how many of you evaluated the answer script or checked the answer script after providing the marks? After you providing the marks to the students, how many of you have checked the answer script again and find out what are the common mistake done by the students? What kind of outcome they have not achieved? So what is required? So suppose I said in my class 80% of the students cannot achieve the outcome number 2. Then what is the interpretation as a teacher I can take? I said 80% of the students has not achieved the outcome number 2. So as a teacher, what interpretation I can take? I can take as an interpretation that is called evaluate the effectiveness of the instruction. I can say that the teaching learning process which I use to develop the skill, second outcome skill, is not appropriate, or the outcome itself is not achievable. So as a teacher, after providing the marks to the students, my job is not over. My job is to find out why maximum students, what is the common problem to the maximum student, which outcome students are not achieving. If it is not achieved, then what is the problem? Is it a problem for teaching learning process, or is it a problem that the outcome which I define is not achievable? So that is called reinforcement of teaching and learning. So every batches you have to take care about this. Now the question is, suppose I take the exam and NSEM exam and find out the outcome number 5, 80% student has not achieved it. The time is gone. So I cannot say those batch time is already gone. So I have to certify them based on their non-achievement performance. To reduce this error, we call periodic assessment is necessary. Most of you take a class test. What you take a class test? Okay, tomorrow you have a class test. You design a question paper and you ask the student to answer it. They will answer it. Oh, you got out of 15, 7. Oh, you got 0. Oh, you got 10. What is the meaning? No meaning. Class test cannot be part of the student's evaluation. The purpose for periodic assessment is to find out students' misconception and provide remedial lessons. Class test is not for evaluation. You cannot evaluate the students based on the class test. Class test, you have said the periodic assessment, so that the same mistake is not happened when you take the evaluate the student at the end of the course, to avoid that or to minimize the error. So any periodic assessment, whether it is a class test, whether it is a quiz, it can be designed based on your course. The purpose is to find out students' misconception and provide remedial lesson. It is not that tomorrow I have a class test, or fine morning, or this time I'll design a class test question. Nobody will get out of 15. Everybody will get out of 6 or 0. This is not the purpose. Purpose is to find out whatever the concept you cover, you design a quiz or design a class test to find out what is their common misconception, and based on the misconception, every individual students or group wise students, you have to provide the remedial lessons. So this is the whole purpose for assessment and evaluation. It is assessment and evaluation is not arbitrary things. Oh, this time I'll design a question paper, nobody can answer. This is not assessment. Assessment to check either two methods. Either you can find out the evidence to destruct their misconception, or you can find out the evidence, or you collect the evidence for their competence. So assessment for evaluation and assessment for misconception correction is different. So periodic assessment cannot be part of the evaluation. Evaluation is when I say that this assessment is judge your competence on the subject. And this assessment I want to take to find out your misconception and provide you remedial lesson. So this is the whole purpose for assessment and evaluation. Most of the time, is most of the universities say, oh, design a question paper out of eight, any student should answer any five. Purpose is not that. Out of eight, student has to answer every eight if all questions are related to my course outcome. Unless I have to design a question paper that any five student choose, it is ensured that all the course outcome map to any five questions. So design is question paper is not that easy for assessment. Design and assessment test item is not that easy for evaluation. It has to be mapped with your course outcome. Okay? And periodic assessment, you have to design class test when you are taking class test, quiz. You have to design such a way the concept which you cover in the class, you have to test whether the student has achieved or acquired the concept or not. So if they not acquired the concept, you have to provide their remedial lessons. Okay? Now I am not going to the details of what is formative evaluation. All of you may know the formative evaluation, summative evaluation. So I have said that our evaluation is maximum class test based, criteria based evaluation. There is another evaluation process called non-reference evaluation. I'm not going details of that because that is not required at that time. That is not the purpose for our teaching. Non-reference evaluation is used when you rank the students. If I want to rank the student 1 to 100, then I have to take the non-reference assessment. If I want to evaluate the competence of the students, I have to take the criteria-based assessment. And criteria-based assessment, once you take, define your evaluation rubrics, multiply with the criteria assessment data, and you get the student's competence as a quantification. Now, formative, summative, I'll share the slide, those are the theory, you can take it. Then there is some called validity and reliability of the assessment. If I ask you, what is the validity and reliability of the assessment? Can you give an answer? What is the validity and reliability of the assessment? Any answer? Anybody can unmute the mic and give an answer?
Sir, predicting the future performance is validity of a test.
Is it future? How do we link the future on your present course?
Sir, whether our we are trying to predicting the performance of the employee or student.
No. When you that assign an EX grade, it is not prediction. It is based on evidence. It is your course. You cannot say whether the students will do the high-end research or not based on your subject. You cannot say. You can only say whether a student has achieved his intended course goal or not. That is your job. Your job is not to find out the predict whether the student is excellent, say, very good researcher. That may not be true. You are only find out, this is my course goal. Are the student achieved the course goal? If it is not, then what is my mistake? So since that mistake is not very big, that's why we have a periodic assessment. Periodic assessment to reduce the mistake. Because in NSEM, you find all students fail, then there is no time to correct it. But that's why the periodic assessment is there.
Sir, periodic assessment is somehow we are trying reliability of our test.
No, periodic assessment is not for part of evaluation. You cannot add the class test marks in your evaluation purpose. Your class test is to find out their misconception and provide remedial lessons. It is not for your assessment purpose. Your assess, when you say the assessment, that should be criteria based, and that based on your course goal. That is a very important issue. So validity is that if your test item is not linked with the course goal, then validity of the assessment is zero. You cannot say, this year I will design a question paper nobody can answer. Oh, I should design a question paper so that everybody got 60% marks. No. It is not the criteria. Your criteria is validity means your assessment test item must be related to your course goal. Suppose in a course you said the student will be able to design AC machine, something AC machine for a given specification, and none of your assessment you test whether they are able to design the AC machines or not, then the validity of your assessment is zero and validity of evaluation becomes zero. Because if the assessment is not valid, then the evaluation is also not valid. Then what is reliability? What is the definition of the reliability? If we said reliable, a machine is reliable if it repeats its performance. That means if a machine produces same result over the long time, can you mute your mic? Because something is okay. Now, what is reliability? Reliability says that if a machine performs repeatedly same thing, then we call machine is reliable. That means over the time period, its performance should not change. Then what is the reliability of your evaluation? So if I define like this way, suppose today I take a test, a student score 100. If I take the same test after 1 month, can I guarantee the student will take score 100 out of 100? If it is not, then what is the reliability of your test? Most of the time we are complaining at the end of 4 years, if I ask the students for any questions from the first year, they cannot answer it. Why? Why they cannot answer the first year subject questions at the end of 4 years?
Because, sir, our examination system is not reliable.
What is the examination system? The examination system is designed by you, not that anybody else. So you are the professor, you are designing the examination system. Today you are not part of the university, maybe tomorrow you will be part of the question setter. Are you have that skill? How do you design a reliable assessment system? So suppose I want to increase the reliability of the assessment system, what should I do? Let's I give you tasks that reliability of your assessment should be increased. If the assessment reliability increased, evaluation also increased. If you analyze why a student is unable to answer any concept of first year subject in fourth year. Why? Because we included the test item which can be answered by one day reading, and after the reading it's completely forgot. Suppose you are teaching a course on VLSI system design and you said a question, write a short note on this. What student will do? Student will just last night read out that short note, or they will come a piece of paper in the exam hall and write down it. Both are same. Whether they are writing from a piece of paper or whether they are writing from their memory, both are same. Both are reliability is zero. So how do you increase your reliability of the test item? Think about, suppose you learn how to ride a bicycle and during 1 month you have not bicycled. After 1 month I give you a bicycle. are you not able to bicycle? If you able to ride the bicycle after 1 month, then why? Because it is skill, it is not knowledge, it is not remembering. So if your assessment is skill based, then the students will never forget it. If your assessment only memorization, the students will forget after the exam. So can you design a test item which is completely skill based, not memorization? Do not ask the students to write a definition of something, Maxwell equation. Not required. Derive this thing for the fx equal to gx. What is the requirement? Derive fx, prove that fx equal to gx. It may be a knowledge. I just remember it before the exam, or I come with a piece of paper and write down, prove that fx equal to gx. Reliability is zero. Instead of that, if I give them an application-oriented test item, given this, derive this parameter, if this parameter is like this, find out this parameter, like that way, that becomes skill. So validity and reliability of the assessment is very important. Validity only increases if your test item directly related to the your course goal. Reliability, if you design the test item to test their skill only, not their memorization skill. Okay, then there is a called item analysis. I'm not going details of the item analysis. You may heard about that there is an item analysis called facilitation value, discrimination index, all those things are there. So suppose I told you, sometimes we say, no, this question is very easy, this question is very difficult. If I ask you, can you objectively verify that this question is difficult with respect to whom? Suppose I am the subject teacher, I give a question. In my case, I can say this question is very easy, but this question may be very difficult to the students. So if I want to objectively measure the whether the test item is difficult or easy, how can you do it? Idea is called, this is already established theory. I think most of you know it, test item analysis. This is called facilitation value, means how easy is the questions. Suppose I have a 100 student class. If I ask a question, if all students give the correct answer, then what is the easiness? 1 or 100%? If none of the students give the answer, then what is the easiness? 0. Is it means the question is difficult? No. It means question is invalid. If I ask a class 12 questions in a class 8 students, none of the students cannot give the answer, then the question is invalid, not difficult question. So if easy, that means every student gives the correct answer. Now in between, if I want to measure that some 60 students give correct answer, what is the easiness? So if it is 60 students give the correct answer, you may say 60% is the easiness, or 0.6 is the easiness. But if you measure this way, this may not be statistically valid. Because most of the time, if I take the distribution of the marks in the class, it will come Gaussian curve. So if I say x-axis is the marks, mean of the marks, let's 100, 90, 80, 70, 60, 50, like this. Y-axis is the frequency of the students, means how many students got 90, how many students got 70. The distribution will come a Gaussian distribution. Now in a Gaussian distribution, you know that there is an upper limit and there is a lower limit. How do you define upper limit, lower limit? Mostly we define by 3 dB down. If it is electronics or electrical faculty may know the 3 dB down we said. What do you mean by 3 dB down? That means 1 by root 2. So 1 by root 2 is 0.7. So I can say that from the 100, the 30% of the students, so this is the distribution curve. So 30% of the students from the upper side is called upper group, and 30% of the students from the lower last students is called the lower group. So suppose I have a test item like this. Is visible to everybody?
Yes sir.
So now say that there is a test I have taken. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 questions are there, and let's the highest marks is 5, and the correct answer is C, C, B, C, D. Now I have a 15 students and I take the test, and I rank them as per their total marks. Now I want to find out whether the test item 1 is easy or difficult. What is the fascination value of the test item 1, or what is the easiness index of the test item 1? So if every test item carry 1 marks, that means 1 to 15 students are there. So 30% from the top side, 30% means 30% of the 15 students means 4.5 students. So I can say 5 students. So 30%, so top side 5 students, 1 to 5, okay, and bottom side 5 students, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, okay. So 15, 14, 13, 12, 11. So if bottom 5 and top 5 give the correct answer, then the easiness is 1, like in test item 4. So all bottom students give correct answer, all lower students also give correct answer. So that's why easiness index is 1. So what should be the formula? The marks obtained by the upper group, marks obtained by the lower group, I will add them and divided by the total marks of upper group and lower group. So marks obtained by the upper group, five students are there. So every student give the correct answer. So 5 into 1. Marks obtained by the lower group, again 5 into 1. So 5 into 1 plus 5 into 1. This one is what? This one is the marks of that test item divided by upper group student is 5, lower group student is 5. So 5 plus 5 into 1. So 5 into 1 plus 5 into 1 divided by 5 plus 5 into 1 is equal to 1. Similarly, calculate the for test item 1. How many student upper group give correct? 4. So 4 into 1 plus lower group students, 3 into 1. So 4 plus 3 divided by 5 plus 5 into 1. So 4 plus 3 means 7 divided by 10. So for any test, I can find out the easiness index of that question. So this type of questions are easy. This type of questions, item number 4, this type of questions are very easy. And this type of question is easiness is 0.7. This type of question easiness may be less. So it doesn't mean the question is difficult. Easiness 0 is not means the question is difficult. Easiness 0 means the question is useless or question is invalid. So what is the difficulty index? If I say, how do you calculate the difficulty index from the same question? What do you mean by difficult? Difficult means good students will able to answer, bad student should not be able to answer. So if a question is able to answer by only good students, none of the bad students, then I say the difficulty index is 1. So I only want good students should give answer, bad students should not give answer. So if all good students give correct answer and none of the bad students give correct answer, then I say difficulty index is 1. Now, if some of the bad students also give correct answer, then what the difficulty index? Like test item 3. All upper group 5 students give correct answer. So, the lower group 5 students give correct answer means question is not that difficult. So, I can say the marks obtained by upper group minus marks obtained by the lower group divided by the total upper group marks. So, I can say 5 minus 3 divided by 5. Similarly, if the question is essay type, no problem. Suppose this one. So, marks obtained by the test item 1, marks obtained by the upper group. So, 10 students is there. So, 30% students means 3 students. So, let's these 3 students. I color them red. Then, lower group 3 students, color them red. So, facilitation value, marks obtained by upper group, 10 plus 9 plus 10. Marks obtained by the lower group, 8 plus 8 plus 8. So, how much? 10 plus 9 plus 10, 29 plus 24. So, 29 plus 24 means 29 plus 24, it is come around 53. Divided by, if all upper group student correct answer, that means 10 plus 10 plus 10, so 3 into 10, the question carry 10 marks. So, 3 into 10 plus 3 into 10. So, 53 divided by 60 is the facilitation value of this test item 1. Similarly, what is the difficulty index or discriminative index? Or difficulty value, difficulty index? How difficult is the question? 29 minus 24 divided by 30. Is clear? Okay. So, I am not going details. I will share the slide. You can read it. It is very easy. Then I come to the multiple choice questions. Okay. So, what is multiple? How do you design multiple choice question? So, here I can say I have designed a multiple choice question. Most of the time you find multiple choice question option are only 4. Why? Any answer? Why multiple choice question has only 4 options? Anybody can give answer? Why multiple choice question has only 4 options? Why not it is, how many options should be there? All of you are listening or just?
No, sir, we are listening, but we don't know the answer.
Don't know the answer. So, in your opinion, how many choice should be there? How do you design a multiple choice question? Most of you have done it, I think so.
Yes, when we are designing the multiple choice questions, we need to design the options in such a way that if a student is having certain kind of misconception,
yes,
what kind of answer he would arrive, and that answer should be present in the options.
Yes, that means the multiple choice question should not have only 4 choice. It will depend on the possible misconception present in the questions. So, if a question is suppose 2 into 3, or suppose such a question where there is no misconception or one misconception only, then the choice will be only 2, correct choice and misconception choice. So, when you design a multiple choice question, each choice, one is the correct answer, other are the choice, each choice must be related to the possible misconception. If it is related to the possible misconception, then only the multiple choice question is good. Unless suppose I said 2 by 5 and I have given 4 choice and I said 1 is 1.5, 1 is 2.5 and only one choice is there, which is less than 5, less than 1. It is obvious that without knowing that division, a student can give the correct answer. Because everybody knows that 2 by 5, it will be less than 1. So your choice must be related to the possible misconception. Sometimes you said all of the above, none of these. Can you say what is the misconception of this choice? So forcefully given a choice is not that good. So how do you analyze whether your choice is effective or not? Suppose in the test item, you say the one, this slide is visible. So suppose you test question number one, there is a four choice, A, B, C, D. Now I want to find out, C is the correct choice. I want to find out what is the effectiveness of the each of the misleading choice or misconception link choice. If you see, in test item one, none of the students had choose B and D. That means the choice of B and D is not necessary, or effectiveness of those destructors is zero. They does not have a capability to distract the students. So they are not linked with any misconception. That means effectiveness of the destructor is zero. So whether you go give those choice or not doesn't matter. So how do you find out the effectiveness of the destructor? Who will be destructed more? Lower group students. So number of the choice chosen by the upper group to number of upper group students minus number of lower group students divided by the upper group students number. Here is not marks. So in case of test time number one, A, the lower, how many lower group students choose A? 1, 2, 3. Minus how many upper group students choose A? 1. Divided by 5. Sometime it may becomes negative. Suppose A is only choose by only one upper group students, none of the lower group students choose. This is arrived. Then it will be 0 minus 1 divided by 5, so it is negative. What is the meaning of that? That means when you design the question is misleading or confusing. That's why a good student confused with the correct answer. So design a multiple choice question is not that easy. You have to think about it, that how do I design the multiple choice question, what is the concept on it, and what kind of misconception is there. Suppose that I have given this example I have given many times, that 8 to the power 2. If I say what is the value of 8 to the power 2, what are the possible misconceptions? What are the possible misconceptions of calculate the value of 8 to the power 2? I think everybody can give that answer. What are the possible misconceptions? So possible misconception is either a student will add these two numbers, so they can give an answer 10, or a student can multiply this number, they can give an answer 16, or they can give a correct answer. There is nothing called all of them or all of the above. Nothing is there. So I can have a multiple choice question, 8 to the power 2, choice A 10, choice B 16, and choice C is the correct answer. Is clear? Sometime we have provided the question paper such a way that the whole question is misleading. I'll show you. Just a minute. Again, it is. I'll show you. Suppose this is your question. Everybody can read it?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So now, can you figure out what you have to do? Suppose this question is given to the students. What happened? What does the cone do? What will happen? Many times we have given this kind of stuff. What to do? What do it? So do not provide a question which is invalid or which is misleading. Because I said the validity of the question is zero if the question is misleading. Instead of giving this kind of questions, you provide a valid concrete question. Calculate this thing. So here, this purpose of this question is to find out whether the students know Archimedes principle or not. So I can say that calculate the density, calculate the volume, determine the density instead of what does the cone do. Understand? So that's why this way you have to design the question paper. Unless you design the question paper this way, once you take the test, it will be invalid test. Don't think that you have to design a question paper to pass the students. There is nothing called pass and fail. You have to only certify whether they are competent or they are not. You may say, sir, if I design this type of question paper, most of the students fail. Then our university will say me, why your subject, all the students is fail. You design the question paper like this way. Since your university not allow you to fail anybody, you can pass them. But you counsel the students that you have not acquired this skill. It will very much important for your next year's subject. As a teacher side, you will be very clear. Think about, a student got 30% marks in analog electronics, promoted to the VLSI design. Are you think you will do better in VLSI design? I'm not saying that he can get an EX grade from that subject. I'm not saying the grade. I say the valid grade. Can he get a valid and reliable grade? No. But at least you can identify that what is your gap. What is the gap of the students? And you can counsel the students, this is your gap. If you not do it, that is your problem. None of the system can give you 100% efficiency. So in a class, you can say, okay, if I taught for a class in perfect way also, 60% students will successful. 40% will not success, whatever you do it. But at least you will be clear that I have taken that assessment which I have certified their competence, and I have taken the assessment, I have counseled each and every student and told them this is very important for your next class. Don't think about that I have to pass the student, I have to make the question paper very easy. Who said this, why said this, when said this, why require those questions? Write a short note on this. In engineering subject, sometimes if you give a write note, a short note on this, it is very, you can say the pathetic thing. That assessment is totally invalid. Now I come to that, I just give you that, this is very important when you go for the attainment calculation of your COPO. Very important. Unless your assessment and evaluation is valid and reliable, you cannot calculate the attainment of your CO. It is not based on the, okay, students has got 80% marks. If your question is not related to your course goal, that 80% doesn't have any effect. Okay, so what we'll do, today I stop here. And tomorrow I will calculate the attainment, because today already 12:30 is there, 12:20. So I can take a question answer session, and tomorrow I will calculate the attainment and COPO mapping. Okay?
Yes, sir. Yes.
So any questions from participant, they can ask.
Sir, Sir, we are into the tier 2 system, and the question paper is mostly prepared by the university in term examination.
That is the biggest problem in calculation of attainment. You yes, cannot sir. Calculate the attainment unless the mapping between your course outcome and question is given to you. I'll show you that is very much important. So my purpose is not that today you can do it, but think about that tomorrow you may become that question paper setup of your university. So that time you keep in your mind that what question you should set. It is not that, okay, that student has to get a pass mark, they cannot pass if a question paper is like this. There is nothing called pass and fail marks. If you see, most of the time students are practicing last 2 year question paper before the exam. Why? Because they try to find out what is the teacher's outcome. What type of question teachers are doing. It is 100% predictable. If your assessment system is like this, then your total evaluation is non-reliable. Today, if you see, I'm giving this out of context. This is, I'm giving a remarks only, not it is a statement. See that in a board exam, if the question paper is leaked, then maybe 95% student get 100 out of 100. If a question paper is not leaked, then 90% students will get 100 out of 100. Then are you think that question is valid and reliable? So whether the question paper is leaked or not leaked, there is nothing statistical significant difference of the result is coming out. So that means question paper is totally invalid. Are you think today who score 100 out of 100 is a good in maths? So that means it is assessment, if it is not reliable, then it is a bad impression to the students. I got 100, but I do not know anything about the course. Yeah, that is the important issue.
Yes, this is the actual problem. That student is graduated in the technical education and they are not confident, as well as even the employers are not confident about their score sheets. So most of the time employers are also not showing any kind of confidence into the grade.
Since, and this is a reverse side effect, since that our education system totally grade based, student never thought that reading is important. They thought once I get the grade I am clear. Because yes, we have imposed this. If yes, we change the assessment system, you see that whole system will come in learning instead of the grade. Any questions from other participant? Nobody has unmuted their mic.
Participants, you can unmute yourself. And then you can ask your questions directly to the sir. Please.
I have given you a evaluation assessment, no? Are you able to answer that after this lecture, this facilitation value and discriminated index? Yes. Any confusion?
Sir, there is one question in the chat box.
No, nothing is appear. Now ask, why evaluation is sometimes called judgmental. See, evaluation is what? Evaluation is quantification of the student's competence. Evaluation is not assessment. The question you ask is assessment. Based on the answer, when you quantify that this student is 10 out of 10, this student is 8 out of 10, that is called evaluation. That's why it is judgment. Suppose you are, sometime you take a seminar, no? Student seminar or grand viva. What is your evaluation matrix? Evaluation matrix means you can say in the grand viva, there will be 10 questions will ask to the students and every questions carry 2 marks. So out of 20, student has to score and I will give the grade based on that. So that is called evaluation matrix. If I take a seminar, you was present in the seminar, after the seminar, oh, you got 90, oh, you got 70. If a student challenge you, why you give me 70? So before the seminar, what you do? You design a evaluation matrix. That means the competence weightage, your presentation capability will get 10 marks. Your definition of the problem get 10 marks. Slide get 10 marks. Report get 10 marks. So based on that matrix, now you evaluate. Now you take the assessment. Student is giving presentation means you are assessing the students. Based on the assessment, now you provide the competence. Oh, your presentation is good. So out of 10, 8. Your slide is good. Out of 10, 5. Your report is very good. Out of 10, 8. Then you add them and evaluate the students. It is not that you sit there, oh, you ask the questions and evaluate the students. This is not the happening. Any else? Anybody else? Are you able to answer that assessment I have given? Calculate the facilitation value, discriminant index. Are you able to do it?
Yes, sir. Sir, questions will be asked, it will be shared by the end of session.
Okay. So now there is no confusion in the presentation. Validity, reliability, all those things you understand. That's why you see the job of the teacher is much more. Never design a question paper is not required only 1 hour or 2 hours. It may require entire month, or it may require entire year.
Yes, sir.
That's why when you see that how many have write down your course outcome in the framework? Have you write down anybody?
We would develop from our department. I have told to my
all participant. All participant can develop in the FDP Jodhpur. If you are not belongs to your institute, they can develop under FDP Jodhpur. Register their course in computer science and write down your course outcome. I want to see it tomorrow. That everybody has at least 5 course outcome is written. 5 to 6.
Yes, sir.
Okay, and yes, tomorrow I'll talk about the attainment calculation, COPO mapping, and attributes of good teaching. Okay,
okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.